Мија интервју со британската амбасадорка во Северна Македонија, Ричел Галовај. Добро дојдовте.
Добар ден.
Во ноември во Глазгов ќе се одржи конференција за климатски промени. Велика Британија е домаќин, заедно со Република Италија. Кои се главните насоки во кои што ќе се движи оваа конференција и кои се е најавено дека ќе учествува на неа?
Thank you. So, the United Kingdom will be co-hosting COP26 in November in Glasgow. The main aim of the conference is to get world leaders together to commit to the actions from the Paris Agreement 6 years ago to keep world temperature rise below 1.5 degrees, to show how they're going to deliver on the commitments on net zero for carbon emissions, and to show how countries are going to push past coal. We're expecting leaders and delegations from all over the world, and we were very pleased that President Penderovsky has also confirmed his attendance.
Очекувате ли некаков пресврт на оваа конференција во Глазгов од годинешните преговори? Која е вашата цел за да сметате дека овој коп е успешен? Со оглед на тоа дека наминатиот земјите членки не успеа да постигнат договор за операционализација на Парискиот договор.
So what we're looking for at COP26, it isn't a new negotiating treaty. It's actually for countries to come forward and show how they're really going to deliver against what was agreed at Paris, because at the moment we're failing to meet those commitments, and temperature will rise above 1.5 degrees. The main areas we want to see people make new commitments on are adaptation and mitigation, and come together to show what the rule book will be. So successes, what will success look like? Success will look like that there are agreed documents that come out that show what we're all going to do together, but that actually countries have also set out their individual commitments as well.
Како вашата земја се справува со климатските промени? Кои се трите главни мерки за адаптација и митигација кои британската влада ги презема?
So last year, my Prime Minister announced a really ambitious climate action plan with 10 points around green energy, green finance, green jobs, transport, a whole range of sectors. He has said that we will be putting £12 billion into this strategy. We expect it to create 250,000 new highly skilled green jobs, but we also expect it to create and bring in at least 3 times that much in private sector investment. We were the first country to sign our climate ambition commitments into law, so it is now set in law that we will have reached net zero by 2050, and we've set targets along the way. One of the other sort of really big commitments is our International Climate Finance Facility, which is about how we're going to fund climate change action internationally and work with our partners to really change the way people are investing in fossil fuels and are adapting and mitigating some of the impacts that we're already seeing from climate change. That's our ambition, that's our high-level action, but for it to be effective, we actually need other countries to be taking those actions as well.
Дали во видовте или размислувате за воведување на јаглероден данок во Велика Британија?
So what we've introduced in the United Kingdom is the UK, it's called the UK ETS, it's a UK, United Kingdom Enhanced Trading Scheme. We used to be a member of the European Union one. This is not so much a carbon tax, but we call it a cap and trade policy. So what happens is for certain greenhouse gases in certain sectors, we set a target for how much the emissions can be each year, and we will be decreasing that level over the years, and we expect this to be play a huge part in us reaching net zero.
Каков е планот на големите мултинационални компании кои се производители на фусилни деривати и го носат најголемиот удел во карбон кредитот? Еве пример некој за кој што вие можете да ми кажете.
So, as chair of the COP, one of the things we've been doing is working with the United Nations and others on the Race to Zero campaign, which is a campaign about working with companies and different sectors to get them to commit to some of the changes needed, because you're right, won't be able to deliver the targets if the private sector aren't involved. Actually, now we have thousands of companies worldwide have signed up for it, over 700 cities, academic institutions and businesses. And actually, it's really easy to sign up to it. And over the past few months, we've had really good meetings with different sectors here, transport, big businesses, about what they're doing for climate adaptation. The fact is that businesses are making some of the changes already. They're moving to renewable energies. They're learning what their own carbon emissions are. They have these strategies. But as countries try to make the changes by 2050, the only way these companies are actually going to be economically viable is if they make the changes as well and are able to operate in what will essentially be a relatively wildly different business environment worldwide.
Потекнувате амбасадорка сте на една од развиените земји во светот. На кој начин развиените земји практично им помагаат на земјите во развој да постигнат зелен развој, имајќи предвид дека развиените земји веќе имаат постигнато повисоко ниво на стандард, значи веќе го искористиле карбон кредитот, имаат силни економии, имаат пристап до енергија и високи стандарди, како што споменав, а најранливите земји на климатските промени истовремено треба да ги постигнат тие стандарди, но под сега многу построги услови.
So one of the commitments of Paris was for climate finance to be provided by the developed countries for the developing countries so that they could adapt and mitigate and put into practice the policies needed to adapt for climate change. That commitment was for $100 billion each year. What we need at COP is countries to come forward and show how they're actually now going to meet that commitment. We've doubled what we're giving. We've set out how we're going to do that. We also need at COP to take a second step, which is that the developing countries have come together and they've asked for also, as well as this fund, a long-term finance facility. And what we need to see at COP is an agreement on how we're going to fund that.
Амбасадата на Велика Британија во континуитет поддржува проекти посветени на заштита на животната средина. Стоите за проектот Разбистри се, се вклучија многумине институции и медиуми. Досека дали има некаков ефект или само е уште еден проект кој ќе заврши, свеста ќе остане иста, водата е само еден аспект од заштита на животната средина. Дали во наводници разбистривме водата во земјава?
So, it's a good question. And I think it's a really important campaign. And I think it's something people care about. People know that the lakes are an integral part of the beauty of this country, and they care about them. They care about them as a natural resource, not just an energy source. So I think the campaign has achieved a couple of things. I think the fact that so many organisations have got involved with it and have publicised it has raised awareness. I think the fact that the government has used it as part of its consultation with the Environmental Alliance to form the new law on water and the new laws on mineral resources is incredibly important. But there's still more to be done. There needs to continue to be consultation with the widest range of stakeholders. And then, of course, the real test is going to be in implementation. And we have another project on environmental governance where we're working with the Council for Legal Research, CLRA, about looking at these laws, how they're implemented, what more can be done to ensure that people actually take criminal action where criminal acts have occurred. And I think taking it forward that way will start to genuinely clear it up.
Ги споменавте минералните суровини. Неодамна се одржа јавна расправа за новиот предлог закон за минерални суровини. Се одржа токму во рамки на овој проект Разбистри се. Имате ли мислење за овој закон, бидејќи запознаени сте со проблематиката? Дали според ваша оценка Министерството за економија даде оптимално решение за минералните суровини во земјава?
So, as I said, I think one of the really positive things has been the consultation. I think what we've seen of all the reforms in the countries, the best ones have been the ones where the government and the institutions have involved the civil society sector and the experts. So that's from my starting point that that is a good starting point. But the test again is going to be around implementation. And I think that what we need to see now is about transparency and accountability. So people need to be able to see how the ministry grants concessions in this area, and then the stakeholders will be able to hold the government to account.
Имплементацијата е секогаш проблем во нашата земја. Се надеваме дека тоа ќе се смени. Активни сте во проекти за заштита на животната средина. На кој друг начин ја поддржувате земјата во таа сфера, во однос на климатските промени, освен проектот Разбистри се кој што го споменав?
Through our Good Governance Fund, we have supported the development of the energy strategy and the work on the implementation of the energy strategy. And we're really impressed by how the government has set out how it's going to move forward towards a green and sustainable energy future. We've also worked in the areas of awareness raising, working with smaller NGOs. We have a new project about to start, actually called Hotels for Bees, but about how to get bees back into the environment. We held a sustainable fashion show earlier in the year and are continuing our work with the textile industry because that's an industry which does have an impact, particularly around waste. And in terms of positive news, it was good to see the new waste laws were passed in Parliament this week.
Малку во друга насока, климатските промени мислам дека ги разработивме до сега, колку што можеме во овој интервју. Северна Македонија е 30-та земја членка на НАТО, сојузници сме во најголемиот воено-политички сојуз во светот. Неодамна со Министерката за одбрана, мислам дека во јули подпишавте меморандум за соработка, меморандум за келија за координација на обуката на полигонот Криволак, за затврстување на капацитетите на македонската армија. Што вклучува оваа соработка и дали откако сме земја членка на НАТО, се зајакна соработката во војната сфера или можеби во други сфери?
So, we really, obviously, were a strong supporter of North Macedonia becoming a full member of NATO, and it was a great success. And we were very pleased to be signing the Memorandum of Cooperation earlier this year. A lot of the work we've done over the last couple of years has been focused on helping North Macedonia become NATO ready, particularly through training of the light infantry brigade, which North Macedonia will be providing as part of its commitment to NATO. In Krivolak, we are supporting a variety of training, new targetry, support for both infantry and special forces training. And we've also brought into the country it's called the Land Coordination Cell, but that's about having a permanent UK military presence here to help understand the training needs, both here and actually wider in the region, and then to help set out how we can support and build that support going forward.
Дали откако сме земја членка на НАТО ја закрнавме соработката и во други сфери освен нели во војната?
Well, we've brought into the country a full-time one-star transformation advisor. So he's been working with the Ministry of Defence and the military on what more can be done on all sorts of areas of NATO readiness. We have the whole range of activities at Krivolak. Next year, we will have UK Air Force training alongside soldiers here in North Macedonia as part of some of the big exercises. And we're also about to start a project where we'll be working with the Ministry of Defence on sort of human resources and administration reform, which fits in with some of the wider work we've been doing more broadly with the government over the last few years.
Дел сме од НАТО, но за ЕУ перспективата во моментов се уште не изгледа далеку, особено после блокадата што имаме со Бугарија, спорот што настана со Бугарија изминатиот период. Очекувавме дека ќе започнеме преговори, но сепак сега спориме за идентитетот и јазикот. Вие повеќе не сте дел од ЕУ, меѓутоа бевте долги години дел од ЕУ, дел сте од Европа. Дали сметате дека ова што се случува со Северна Македонија па и со Албанија во целиот пакет е слабост на Европската унија или на земјите кои што сакаат да станат членки на Европската унија?
I think the first thing to say is to note that North Macedonia has done an enormous amount on the reform agenda, from tackling corruption, rule of law, and it's because of this that North Macedonia is a member of NATO and has had strong recommendations to start the accession processes, to open the accession negotiations with the European Union. We have always supported strongly North Macedonia's Euro-Atlantic ambitions, and we believe that the candidate countries should be assessed on the criteria and they shouldn't be stopped by bilateral disputes. I would note, however, that North Macedonia has actually showcased itself as a leader in the region, in fact the wider region, in the approach it's taken to bilateral disputes, and I hope that things will be resolved quickly. But in the meantime, the most important thing North Macedonia can do is continue delivering the reforms, not for the EU, but because they improve the lives of their citizens, and that's what matters.
Сето тоа е така, меѓутоа ете граѓаните како да се дезинспирираат понекогаш поради ваквите случувања. Земјава неудобно одбележа 30 години на независност. Имаме долгогодишна меѓусебна соработка Северна Македонија и Велика Британија. Кои области се приоритет во моментот на вашата влада, амбасада како поддршка за земјава, но и регионално?
Okay, so it's been a real pleasure to celebrate 30 years of independence with the 30th member of NATO. We've, as you said, we've had really long-standing cooperation in a range of areas, and I think our priorities are aligned with those of the country. So we've been focusing on support to rule of law, good governance, public administration, and as we've already discussed in this interview, we've been doing a lot on the environment as well. I think those are the areas we'll continue to work in with the government, with non-governmental organisations, with international partners. We also are working with some of the large international institutions, the United Nations, the World Bank, on really important issues such as tackling gender-based violence, and also a huge project for the next 20 years on the development of a national development strategy. Regionally, our focus is very similar, but we also have some really good projects going on across the region on rule of law and the independence of the media. And I think these will all be areas we continue to focus on going forward.
Како оценувате билатералната соработка во сферата на економијата? Споменавте други области, меѓутоа, каде е тука економската соработка, бизнес релациите, што тука може да се стори повеќе?
So I think that the bilateral business and trade relationship is a fundamental part of our relationship. So in 2020, the trade exchange with North Macedonia and the United Kingdom was £1.4 billion. For the United Kingdom, North Macedonia is our largest trading partner in the Balkans. I think it accounts for 60% of our trade. But we think there's a lot more that can be done, and we can really build on that cooperation in a range of areas. So we've put a lot of time and effort into that. We've agreed and signed a new partnership and cooperation and trade agreement at the end of last year, and we're continuing to work on that. We appointed a trade envoy for the region, which is Martin Vickers MP, who I hope will be visiting here later this year. And we also appointed a trade director in the embassy here in Skopje. And all of these people, all of these issues give us the opportunity to really focus on where we can see new opportunities for cooperation. And actually, there's a whole range of them, but we look at the opportunities for green finance, UK export finance facility, where we can really increase some of the skills exchange that we're already seeing now, but also work with the government on opening access to markets and ensuring an equal fair play field.
Дали вашето излегување од ЕУ имаше некакво влијание врз целата оваа трговска размена во позитивен или негативен смисла?
So the most important thing for us was that it didn't have any negative impact, and we wanted to use it as an opportunity, and that's why we negotiated the PCTA. And the important thing is it came in advance of any changes, So for us, that's been really positive, and we're working with firms to find new opportunities and new ways of working with us.
Познати сте по очивник стипендијата. До кога се отворени апликациите оваа година и што добиваат оние што ќе добијат една ваква стипендија?
Okay, so applications are open now. They close on the 2nd of November. They offer an opportunity for citizens of the country to go to the United Kingdom, study in our best universities to do a one-year postgraduate studies course. We're looking for future leaders, change makers, people who want to go and learn in the UK and then come back and give the things, the skills that they've learned, the knowledge they've gained, and use it for the future of this country. So I urge anyone watching or who knows someone who could apply to go to the Chevening website and apply now.
Thank you very much. Ви благодарам за интервјуто кое што го дадовте за Мија.
Благодарам.